Thank you for listening to my talk and being here. It's a total honor. It's my first time on the JSConf stage, but I've had a handful of friends who have, so. This is the title of my talk, Secure Crypto for Browser-Based Apps. In the last year, some of you may have heard of this guy, Edward Snowden, and the revelations that he made about the NSA and GCHQ. He didn't really talk about malicious hackers, but rather the exploits that they could be using to be stealing your data. And while some people might not worry so much about government surveillance, there are malicious hackers out there. So being secure is kind of helpful regardless of who your enemy is and what your threat is. In the last year, we also saw a huge rise in cryptocurrencies. About a year ago, the number of Bitcoin wallets that were registered were less than 500,000, and now they're over 2. So there's a whole bunch of other cryptocurrencies, and all of those are based on a lot of the same principles as normal cryptography and security. But good news is that Snowden said the bottom line is that the crypto does work. All of the math, he never saw any evidence that the NSA has any crazy quantum computers or anything that can actually break the math that's out there. So, you know, strong crypto is this necessity for a free and democratized internet. You know, we really need it in order to have secure communication, secure file transfer. And when we start getting into things like cryptocurrency, it's important because that's your money, if you're into that sort of thing. I will say first off, I am not a cryptographer at all. I'm a UI UX designer, and I've been working on this project called MailPile for the last year. It is a secure way to read, write, and organize piles and piles of email. We started adding encryption features when we started working on it, right about when the Snowden stuff started leaking, and we realized this is something we really need to focus on a lot. So we consulted with the security community, and we came to the conclusion that we are weird, and we are not going to do any JavaScript cryptography. So, you know, I know you're at a JS conference, so maybe you're hoping to see that, but the talks yesterday were more about that. I'm going to go into it a little bit in the current state and why we chose not to go with it. So one of the first aspects of cryptography and public-private key cryptography is secure key generation. You need to generate a secure key in order to communicate, in order to sign and verify and send data. And here's an example that somebody made recently about JavaScript cryptography. And saying, you know, using elliptic curves instead of prime number factorization, we can generate much faster keys, and he's going to generate the random numbers and the keys right here while the keybase PGP is still trying to hunt for primes. And he was bragging about how fast JS is at this and how that's really, really awesome. But right about here, he typed a command that was window.crypto. And that's kind of one of the backbones of cryptography, is generating random numbers. Tim's talk yesterday focused a lot on this, and it's really awesome, and it's a really exciting API that, you know, we're going to hopefully integrate into MailPile at some point in the future once it stabilizes a little bit more. But, you know, when we looked into it a year ago, you know, this was as of 2 days ago. They just updated their site because some of the APIs have stabilized a bit, but basically window.crypto is very, very not supported in a lot of browsers. Well, okay, so why not choose an HTML5 app, you know, like a Chrome app, or a Firefox app, or an Opera app, or an IE app? You know, I don't think there is an IE app, but anyway, you get the point. And in that case, you would know you're getting a browser that has the APIs available to you, and then you could be running and doing the cryptography in JavaScript, which would be cool. But email, you know, you're dealing with large volumes of email data. We'd have to write numerous browser-specific shims to access the file system in each one of those apps, and that would kind of become a nightmare. And the big no-brainer is that, like, there's not really SMTP or IMAP, you know, support from a browser app. I believe Firefox OS is making progress, or I mean, they have, you can do that in Firefox OS, but as far as the rest of browsers, it's not quite doable. Another big aspect is obviously the code integrity. As JS files get downloaded from the server to your device, this could switch at any point. You know, they could be hijacked, and malicious code could be put in, and your keys and your communications would then be compromised. So all told, you know, we really felt that, like, JS is getting there, but it's not quite there yet for our needs. However, there are some really, really, really solid JS crypto apps out there, like CryptoCat and MiniLock by this guy Nadim. So if you're really into that sort of thing, you should follow along with him and what he's doing and try out his apps, because MiniLock is a file encryption app, and CryptoCat is a chat app. And they're really great. They're getting audits by the security community, and he's making a ton of progress in that direction. So I'm going to segue kind of back to our approach of what we built. Call it browser-based apps because, you know, it runs in a browser. Duh, right? It's on a .com. But we also have this idea of local browser-based apps, which is a little bit strange. So, like, bear with me and have some patience here. Like, you know, imagine running an app on localhost. You know, as a web dev, you probably are familiar with this, but the rest of the world is kind of like, what? I don't really understand that. That's not a viable solution. That's not really an app. I go to the internet, right? I use a browser to go on the internet. This idea of localhost is terrifying to them. So what we're going for is kind of this hybrid app. We have a Python backend and an HTML5 frontend that renders the interface that people interact with. We have native installers for macOS and Windows, and native integration like the toolbar and the tray bar on Windows. So you can install it really easily and then access it, and it feels like more of a native app. It just spins up a browser window instance when you're ready to access it. So you might be shaking your heads right now like, OK, wait, what? This guy, what are you talking about? But there's a lot of really good reasons that we wanted to experiment with this style of app. One thing, there's a much larger talent pool in the front-end community. You know, web versus native developers is roughly 68%. I'm getting the statistic from GitHub, looking at GitHub repos. And I realize these are not exact numbers. I mean, some web apps are written in Java, and you know, some desktop native apps are written in Python. But the kind of difference in why I'm saying this is a web app is that it's rendering in the browser and not using a native, like something to render the GUI like Qt or something else. There's also a lot of deployment options when you build an app like this, right? You can deploy it to your local computer and run it like a native app, or you could deploy it to your server and access it over the network. As long as it's done securely, that's pretty great. And then you get a ton of benefits that your interface can respond and adapt to whatever device is accessing it. So as developers of the app, we only need to write like one real interface logic. We don't have to have multiple ones in different languages or, you know. So then the question is like, well, where's the crypto going to happen? And why does this approach make crypto secure in some way? So imagine we have the HTML5 front end that requests data or interacts with the application. That gets sent to a Python backend over a REST API or from like Jenja templates that get rendered. And then it talks to a GNU PG binary and passes the data back through that flow. And so basically, the front end code never really actually interacts with any of the super mission critical crypto things like your private keys, which is a huge security gain because GNU PG has, you know, been around for a really long time. It's got a ton of people's eyes on it who are really respected security auditors and developers. So it's not some sort of bleeding edge thing that's likely to, you know, expose somebody's safety. Yet, however, you know, things like Heartbleed do happen even with these projects. But again, the security community really feels kind of use things like this and you'll be much better off. So the benefit to us as front-end developers, if that's where you fall in this room, is that we never have to touch crypto code. You don't need to learn about crypto code. You don't need to learn about that and then thus compromise your own privacy because you accidentally didn't understand the right place to pass the right variable or the right type of data structure or whatever that then leaked your data or your key. Another benefit of building apps with this style is that your backend developers can access and interact with many, many, many other parts of the operating system. Like, we're going to be bundling Tor with the application to do more secure anonymous requests. And you couldn't really do that in a browser app. And GPG Tools is another like desktop PGP app. But if you need power user features of that because you're doing a lot of security stuff, the APIs will all still hook and interact. And you'll be able to share the same keys within your mail pile as well as GPG Tools. So there's kind of this rising trend that I've noticed, that there's these local browser-based apps that are doing this. We're not the only ones doing this strange thing. One is called Tag Spaces, and it's a really cool, like, how do you describe it? It's a great way to organize your files on your computer. It gives you a much more interesting power user way of browsing pictures, tagging them, sharing them, archiving them in whatever way you need to do. NovaCut is a really cool collaborative film editing platform. And Metapolator is going to be a font creation app that I believe Metapolator's Python, but NovaCut's Python. Metapolator's built on Hoodie. And TagSpaces is also a Node app. So it's definitely there's people in the JS community that are interested in this, because two out of those three are written with JavaScript backends. So another big aspect is that JavaScript is absolutely perfect, create amazingly fresh and usable interfaces. And that's one of the biggest things that PGP needs, because when I got involved with it, everybody's like, oh, PGP, the interface, can you do something? You're a designer. Oh, I mean, please help. And PGP is like really kind of like this dragon, this multi-headed hydra. Depending on who you talk to and how you talk to them, they're going to say like, oh, well, this is the problem. The key servers are the problem. Or no, the fingerprint or the web of trust or blah, blah, blah. And it just goes on and on and on. But I think I have a theory about why it's such a nightmare. And I'll get to that in a few more slides. But a year ago, I kind of created my first PGP key. Quick poll, like how many of you have ever created a PGP key? That's not bad. And how many of you use them? Like, okay. And how many of you feel confident that you understand PGP? Okay, there's like maybe like five people that did the last round. So that's good. I don't feel too bad, because the first key that I created, I can't even use anymore because I accidentally deleted the private one the same day because of these reasons. I was like, oh, one of my friends has a 1024-bit key, and I or has a 4096-bit key, and I created a 1024-bit key, and wait, like, that must be bad. And then sure enough, one of my friends is like, yeah, that's pretty bad. It can pretty much be cracked at this point. And the user should never be thinking about this or knowing about this. And it's again, the culture of the people who have been building the software for all these years. They kind of don't think about it. You know, and then there's actions like, send me your public key, and what do? You have this big block of text, you're supposed to email it. You know, there's never a real clear way of what to do with it. You have to export it from one app and import it as an attachment, or, you know, and then you send it and it gets sent wrong somehow, or you accidentally encrypt it. So it just leaves you feeling pretty frustrated. And the interfaces for these apps look like this. You know, this is the view of what my key looks like in GPG tools. And I'm not knocking them. They're awesome guys. And I'm actually collaborating with them to share icons and some user interactions between our project and their project. So it's more of a unified user experience. But like, here's an example of their keychain. And it looks like something from 10 years ago, 15 years ago. It's this really boring tabular list with a bunch of cryptic numbers on one side and names. And you go, OK, I think I understand. And here's kind of what we're going for in MailPile. We're going for more of like a social networking sort of experience of people, because it's really about people. You know, we don't really have, the keychain has disappeared. And this is because I come from the world of web dev and being a front-end developer and a UX designer. You know, I don't think in terms of like, how do I accurately represent the integrity of this data at paramount? I think about, well, what does it mean to a user? And I think as a front-end person or persons in this room, that is the sort of thing we can bring to these older school applications when being developed in a local context. So there's like more than crypto, you know. Fixing older interfaces and experiences from a web development standpoint could be quite interesting. MailPile has like a REST API. You know, it's a pretty standard issue that I'm sure everybody in this room is used to interacting with in some way. And that enables us to do a lot of interesting things, like build creative plugins, like this one that looks kind of like TweetDeck. You know, where you're used to these columns of emails, you know, which is going to be, again, more interesting and new and fresh than traditional tabular list-based email clients. Here's another example of one we've been working on, and it's force-directed graphs using the D3 library. And that's my social graph of a given email search. So I'm searching for, you know, IndieWeb, which is this community I'm a part of. Whereas if I do JS, I get a different social graph. And the next level is building and things to do with all those nodes, obviously, and interact with it. But I find that pretty interesting instead of just a traditional email list. We also have a command line interface that we're going to expose through pipes and such at some point. But you can also use it basically as like a data store of how to interact with email data. And one of the big things we really care about is like decentralizing the web. You know, instead of having these large centralized monolithic entities where everything is a web server owned by a big company up in the cloud, we're saying, you know, hey, let's re-expose the local host, re-expose your local computer, and have it be accessible through something like ngrok or PageKite or even Tor hidden services. You know, it's a pretty cool thing. Like, I could expose my laptop here and anybody in the room could start accessing it. So basically, when you do that, local becomes a server again. So your email could live on your private computer at home. You could punch through the NAT and then be accessing it from your mobile devices, and you don't ever have to trust in a third party to access or hold your data. That's how a lot of the internet used to be back in the 90s, and then it started to shift this other direction because it's a little bit easier in some senses. But the tools are out there, and we can work towards it. So it's like there's a demo online if you find this project interesting and you want to explore what a new approach to email looks like. Go to our website, milpal.is, because we're from Iceland, and demos. We have it in different languages. Phone and tablet support is coming soon. And we actually just released our beta last night quietly. We haven't really publicized it yet, so you're the first people in the room who know about that. And we'd love to have you download it, check it out, use it, file bug reports, send pull requests, suggest dream features, and yeah, basically anything that you find interesting about email or want to change or improve. I'm Brennan Novak, and my PGP key is in that QR code, if you're into that. Thank you very much.